Let's continue our study of sorting algorithms by examining insertion sort. Now, here's the algorithm for insertion sort. It's very similar to sorting cards as they're dealt. So one at a time, what you do is you put the next card in sequence with respect to the previously sorted cards. So we're inserting the next card into a sorted order. That's where the name of the algorithm comes from. And as I mentioned before, it's very important that you know not only the steps in the algorithm, but you match the name to those particular steps, because that's how we talk about them in computer science. It's also how I ask about them on tests, and so that's important. The challenge to this is the sequencing is tricky to do efficiently. So if you tried to do this sort of by the seat of your pants, you probably wouldn't come up with a good algorithm. So you've got to use the algorithm that I'm presenting here. That is, if you do something else on an examination, it will be marked as wrong. This is really important. So let's take a look at how this works in practice. Now, just as in selection sort, when we were dividing the data into things that had previously been sorted and things that haven't, we're doing the same thing with insertion sort. So for example, when your first card is dealt in the hand, which in this case would be a 5, that means we know exactly where it is. It's in the right place and it's already sorted with respect to itself, because how could it not be? So the first thing we do is we take the second item, which is 3, and we put it in a temporary location. I'm showing this over to the side. Now we compare that temporary location to the value that's in the first position. We can see that 5 is bigger, or 3 is smaller, whichever way you want to think about it, so we move the 5 over. Now notice at this point we do have 5 twice in the array. The 3 is stored to the side, and so we're going to be able to move it back. Because we've hit the end of the array, we can see that 3 has to go in first. So now 3 and 5 are sorted with respect to each other, and we're ready to start our second iteration. So here's the second iteration. Now 1 is the value that we're trying to put in with respect to the others, and so 1 gets moved to the temporary location. Now 1 is smaller than 5, so 5 gets moved over into 1's position. 1 is also smaller than 3, so 3 gets moved over. And then at the end, we move the value from temp into the first position. Let's look at the third iteration now. 4 gets moved into temp. 5 is bigger than 4, so it gets moved over. But 4 is bigger than 3, so 3 does not get moved over. Instead, 4 gets moved in the position that 5 was at first. And so there we have 4 values sorted. Here's the fourth iteration. The 2 gets moved into the temporary position. 2 is bigger than 5, so 5 gets moved over. 2 is bigger than 4, so 4 gets moved over. 2 is bigger than 3, so 3 gets moved over. Now 2 is bigger than 1, so 1 does not get moved over. Instead, 2 gets moved into the position where 3 is. So let's take a look at the last iteration. Now we can see that 6 is bigger than 5, but remember, that's us looking ahead. We can't do that. We have to be very systematic. So 6 gets moved to a temporary location. Now 6 is bigger than 5, so 5 doesn't get moved over, and instead we recognize that 6 is there, that it belongs in its current position. So we've got an interesting boundary condition we had to deal with in this particular case. So let me show you a different way to look at these first 4 iterations. This is a little bit more abbreviated, and this is how I usually do it on a test. So we have different numbers here, so you'll see a second example. You can see we start with 1. Well, 1 is smaller than 3. So although we move 3 over into temp, we don't have to move it back. Then we go to the iteration with 9. 9 gets moved over to temp, but it doesn't get moved back. Now with 4, 4 gets moved over to temp. 9 is bigger than 4, so it gets moved over, and then 4 gets moved in. So it's the same way of expressing these, just without all the arrows involved, and with a way that's a little bit easier to work on a test. Our next iteration is putting 2 in the correct position. So 2 gets moved over to temp. Now 9, 4, and 3 are all going to move over one position because 2 is smaller than those values. And then 2 gets moved back into position. Here are the last two iterations. 6 gets moved over to temp. 6 is smaller than 9, so it gets moved over. 5 gets moved over to temp. 9 is bigger than 5, and 6 is bigger than 5, so they get moved over. And lastly, 5 gets moved into position. When you look at this, this gets all the data sorted. You may want to try a few examples the first way with the arrows to make sure you really understand what's happening in the algorithm before you do it this way. You do need to know how to trace the algorithm this way because this is the way I usually ask it on examinations. So now let's design our loops. The outer loop, we notice, starts at index 1, not at index 0, and progresses to the end of the array. Another perfect case for a for loop. The inner loop starts at the index from the outer loop and moves to the beginning of the array, not to the end of the array. Now notice the inner loop stops when the temp variable is larger than the data, or it can stop when we reach the first array index. With all these different conditions, it's probably easier to use a while loop than a for loop, although it can be done successfully either way. I'm going to show it with a while loop. So here's the code. Notice our outer loop started at position 1 and went to the end of the array. Now, what I'm doing here is moving the data to temp. So temp gets the value of data of start, and our index gets the value of start. Now, while the index is greater than 0, so that's making sure we don't step off the beginning part of the array, and temp is smaller than the data at the index, we move the data over. So that's the step that we're seeing most of the time. Then we subtract 1 from the index. When we get to the end of the loop, we move the temp value into data of index. So notice this code is not very long. It's actually pretty short. It's just a little bit trickier to write is all. So you might be wondering now why we should study sorting algorithms at all. I told you before how interesting the story of sorting is, but let's think about what we're really learning here. Well, first off, this is one of our first exposures to why algorithms matter. We have seen it in another place with linear search versus binary search, but this is reinforcing the idea that how you do things is very important. Since algorithms are essential to computer science, this really gives you a taste of what my discipline is like. What's more, sorting algorithms are the foundation for many other algorithms. So you'll often hear people say, hey, we could do something like selection sort, or we could do something like insertion sort. If you don't know what those algorithms are, you can't really participate or understand that discussion. It's also a really good place to practice theoretical tools. Now, we don't have these theoretical tools yet, but you do see the need for them, because the minute you have two different ways to do things, you have to think about which way is the better way. Now, special circumstances may impact general rules. For example, partially sorted data. I worked out a partially sorted data example in much greater detail for you to enjoy on Janux. So keep programming.